and calling through the faraway towns. Now war is declared and battle come down. London calling to the underworld. Come out of the cupboard, you boys and girls.
Talk to Jonathan.
Jonathan, you there?
Yes, I am.
How you doing?
I'm doing great. It's good to talk to you guys. Today's the first day I'm actually watching y'all's show, and first off, I wanted to say that really, really appreciate it. I'm not myself an atheist, but I love how calm and, you know, just the honesty that you approach every single caller that you have come in. You're not trying to, you know, get anyone mad at you or anything
now,
like
see,
that.
Now,
you're
that's
just there
an
to give information.
Mm. Now, see, that's an exaggeration. I appreciate it, but
I do
get irritated and snippy on occasion, so it's not every caller.
This is why we have our, you know, calming Buddhist cow here. Yeah, yeah. He just
it's a very
look here, he can sit on your shoulder for a while and you're just going to be mellow now for the next five minutes or so at least.
Maybe
I just had a quick thing. The last caller that mentioned Zeno's paradox and said that he was basically fundamentally wrong with his math, and there was actually movements in Greece that were firmly against zero.
Yeah, I didn't know about that. I knew about the Pythagoreans trying to hide the square root of 2 as the mystical truth of the public just can't know about this irrational numbers. I mean, it just
exactly.
I mean,
yeah, it was along that same vein. Yeah, Zeno made that paradox to show to the Greeks that there was something smaller than 1, and that their math was fundamentally broken from the get-go, and that they should really try to adapt their mathematics to something new that would actually work out when you were trying to get to numbers smaller than 1 or decimals or anything like that. It's not just whole integers.
So who first when was 0 first widely? Who was responsible for that?
I believe that 0 was an Arabic concept.
Yeah. The Arabs and the Babylonians, I think, were the first recorded to have it, and I don't think that they had it from the same principles. They came to it in their own ways.
The important thing, and we appreciate the call, Jonathan. I'm going to go and let you go and let everybody know that we got room on the lines now. The important thing is that despite all these gods that were revealing things to people, none of them bothered to reveal 0. None of them bothered to reveal irrational numbers. None of them bothered to explain these conceptual paradoxes. None of them bothered to explain about the speed of light. This is all stuff that we had to kind of figure out.
People had to figure out those sorts of things.
None of them bothered to explain about, you know, viruses and bacteria causing diseases.
This is why I always really have a good chuckle whenever I hear, you know, say, fundamentalists on the Christian television networks talk about how, well, you know, if you look at the Bible, all modern science is in there, and it has been for... It's like, well, you know, if people weren't applying it, what good was it? You know, I mean, if we didn't have... MRIs and cancer treatments, you know, 1,000 years ago. What good was it to have all of that material in there, and why wasn't the revelation of it clear enough to allow people to do things like, inoculate against the Black Death back in the 1300s?
Yeah, why is it that we can only find that stuff with a little selective reading after we've already discovered it?
Modern science in the Bible.
Yeah, you had made a comment about God being. Not revealing.
Actually, I made a comment that none of those claims of God's revealing things revealed information that was relevant.
Right, and you were saying, why didn't God reveal whatever back in the day
Yeah, well, we were talking about people claiming that, for example, modern scientific concepts have actually been present in the Bible for 2,000 years. And my response to that is, well, you know, why then weren't those principles being studied and applied to daily life if they were revealed there? You know.
Well, I would say that it goes back to the idea of Adam and Eve and the fruit of knowledge. That fruit of knowledge was pursued by man. Mm-hmm. Okay, and man went with his knowledge. And God would reveal his ultimate truth, and had God, well, I just wanted to make the quick point that had God revealed his science or math or whatever to humans when they weren't able to conceive it, it might appear as magic, and it might misconvey God's message.
Well, but God being omnipotent and all-knowing and all-understanding ought to have it perfectly within his skill set to explain those things to people in such a way that it was very easy for them to comprehend and wouldn't be terrifying and magical and strange and frightening.
Well, right? Like kind of like a God that's terrible and magic and frightening and strange.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, why is that a problem?
Yeah.
I mean, first of all, even if we were to go with your biblical concept, it wasn't the tree of knowledge. It was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. It wasn't about knowledge and understanding that supposedly came from that tree within the bounds of Christianity. It was an understanding of right and wrong. So, I mean, the tree thing, I mean, doesn't even address the issue. But if the concern is that if God were to reveal something to people who weren't quite ready to understand it, well, why didn't God make them able to understand it?
Yeah. Because that would be spoon-feeding. And that wouldn't be growth. That would be simply, that would be like a robot, building a robot.
Well, how's that like building a robot by making people, if God created the entire world, let's say, this morning, intact with all of the information that we currently have, how is that building robots?
And how is that? Well, how is it any more building a robot than to do what he actually is said to have done, which is lay out a list of do's and don'ts, and if you do the do's, you're okay, and if you do any of the don'ts, you're condemned, damned, whatever. That to me, just setting together a world, putting people in it, and saying, "I am your God. Here are my rules. You must obey me. If you eat from this, eat the fruit of this tree. You did it. Well, there you go. You're cast out. That seems a heck of a lot more like, trying to create robots, because you're saying, "Oh, well, obey me and you'll be fine. Disobey me and you won't." Whereas creating the people that you create in such a way as to where you can explain them to things to them, have them achieve an intellectual understanding of it, have them ask questions, have them learn, maybe try to have them apply their own knowledge to new discoveries. That doesn't seem to me anything like trying to create a robot.
And somebody
quite the opposite, in fact.
And somebody in the control room wanted to point out, so telling people to wash their hands before they eat would have freaked them out? I mean, they don't have to have a complete and absolute understanding of everything, but if God came to Adam and Eve or whoever, in those early days when he was supposedly revealing so much, and said, "Hey, you know what? When I was making you guys, I also created these little monsters that live on stuff and eat on decaying food, so make sure your food's fresh and that your hands are clean before you eat, and this will kind of keep you more healthy." I mean, how much understanding do you have to grasp that?
Well, the idea of bacteria is kind of ludicrous, only because had God told an archaic human, about bacteria, it would become mysticism, because you can't see it, because the understanding of very small...
Well, you can't see God, you can't see heaven, you can't see hell, and yet these are all beliefs that were promulgated and expected to be adhered to. There's lots of things that religion asks you to...
But they're governing beliefs.
No, I can't...
The idea of bacteria wouldn't be governing.
Well, how is it not? I mean,
idea of boils and pestilence, he in fact did bring up the idea of bacteria, with the idea of boils, you'll be stricken with boils. He didn't say they were made of little tiny organisms, but he said, "Don't do this, otherwise you'll be stricken with boils."
Well, then why is it okay to insist that people believe in the unseen and the unknowable and the unprovable if they're governing beliefs, as opposed to if they're not being okay if they're not governing beliefs? I don't get the distinction there, or that has any bearing on anything.
The direction you guys are coming from is that God came down and wrote the Bible with his own mighty hand.
No, actually, we don't believe in a God at all.
You're saying that. With your argument, you're saying that.
Okay.
I'm saying that each little individual thing were revealed to man, and man wrote it down. So man didn't have the concept of bacteria back then. Man didn't have the concept.
And if God is revealing things to people, which is what you believe,
right,
why wouldn't he reveal things that were useful and true?
And he has revealed that. We got electricity. Do you think that...
Whoa. God reveal
about electricity?
About electricity.
It's God gave man his mind, and...
Oh, so therefore everything we learn and discover, God gets credit for, because he gave us a brain. Is that not the weakest argument ever?